Simon & Schuster Audio presents Adrenalized, Life, Def Leppard, and Beyond by Phil Collen, with Chris Epting. Read by Steve West.
For my dad, Ken, and my mum, Connie. Chapter 1. I came into this world on December 8, 1957, in Hackney, a London borough located in East London. A day or so after being born at the Mother's Hospital of the Salvation Army on Lower Clapton Road, I was brought home to 223 Boundary Road, London, where I would spend a large chunk of my life until 1983, when I went on tour with Def Leppard. It was a small row house in a working-class neighbourhood that was considered to be pretty rough. It didn't seem like that at the time, because I had nothing to compare it to. My dad, Ken Collen, was actually born in Wales, even though he grew up in East London. He was a lorry driver, or a truck driver, as they're known in the States, his entire life. He loved driving, so even when he wasn't working, it wasn't a chore for him to drive us all over the place. We'd call it a busman's holiday. That's an old British phrase that describes a vacation on which you still do the same kind of activity you'd normally do in your job. My mum, Connie Collen, née Wheeler, was from nearby Leytonstone. She became a housewife as soon as I was born, and we spent lots of time together while my dad was off on his frequent driving trips for work. I was the only child they'd ever have. As far as my mum was concerned, the sun rose and fell on my arse. My grandmother, my mum's mother, Nan, as I called her, stayed with us because my mum needed a bit more help. My mum's two older sisters, Dorothy and Rosie, were really strong women. My wife, Helen, and I recently went to visit my Auntie Dorothy. She was 92, vegetarian, and doing great. My mum was weaker physically, suffering from a variety of ailments, including asthma, which I think I psychologically inherited from her, and scarlet fever. So my nan was there to lend a hand, even after my mum got married. All of East London was very working class. Hackney, Walthamstow, Leighton, and Leytonstone. Our small house and these surrounding neighbourhoods became my universe as a youngster. I had a paper round, like a lot of other kids, so each day I would set off on foot around the neighbourhood, delivering a variety of different papers to dozens of families. Early on, I lived what I think was probably a very similar experience for lots of other English kids of that period. I had a dog, Coffee, who was a Jack Russell Beagle mix. I was about 4 or 5 years when I got Coffee. I was always so paranoid that he'd run out the door and get hit by a car. This compounded the asthma. As a kid in school, I played a lot of football, or soccer, like everyone else, and we played in the huge area of grassland on the western bank of the River Lee, called the Hackney Marshes. In fact, Hackney Marshes is where my dad first took my training wheels off my bike. The place was later to become a part of the 2012 Olympic Stadium. Talk about expanding your universe. The West Ham, my team, Arsenal and Tottenham teams were all within striking distance, and all the kids supported one of those. Leighton Orient, another football club, was walking distance from my house, but no one supported them because the poor fuckers were in the third division. My dream, like that of all British kids, was to play professional football. One of my fondest memories of growing up is of the weekends and holidays that we would take to Southend, Jawick, Clacton-on-Sea, or Canvey Island. Places at the end of the Thames estuary, where the Thames filters into the North Sea. Even though these places were barely an hour away from home, people of limited means could escape there from the city and feel as though they had entered some exotic playground. I've read recently that Jawick is today considered one of the most deprived areas in the country, but at the time, those trips represented adventure, escapism, and my love of travel. My parents smoked like troopers. They were completely unaware of the hideous side effects this would have on their sickly child, and how it was probably making my asthma worse. Swimming was suggested by my doctor to relieve my asthma, because he refused to place me on an inhaler for fear of me becoming reliant on the drugs. I loved to swim, and was swimming about a mile by the time I was 8 years old. I actually became a fairly decent swimmer and diver, and joined several swim teams while I was in school. As I was growing up, my parents taught me, like many other post-Second World War kids, to appreciate what you have, and not to harp on about what you don't have. They were very frugal, and I know a lot of that stems from the lean years they spent during the war in England. That mentality seeped everywhere, even down to what we ate. As with most families at the time, our diet wasn't quite what I would call healthy. But then again, we managed to survive on British sustenance. That is to say, lots of braised beef, along with plenty of mashed and boiled potatoes. Then, of course, there was also what we Brits called pork scratchings, or pork cracklings, also known as pork rinds, which were just basically fried and roasted pork fat. Another pig delicacy was dripping, which was congealed fat spread on a slice of bread. So once again, I had nothing to compare all of this to until I had my first curry. I would have conversations with my mum, sitting in our small kitchen while she peeled potatoes for dinner. I would sit there quietly as she told me stories about the war with a certain love and pride in her voice, even as she recounted in great detail what it was like to be a child and live through the Blitz in 1940 and 1941, when the Germans launched massive and sustained strategic bombings all across the United Kingdom, when more than 1 million London houses were destroyed or damaged, and more than 40,000 civilians were killed. My mum and her family would hop from bomb shelter to bomb shelter throughout her neighbourhood, and by forces of both luck and common sense, they managed to survive. As the adage goes, what didn't kill everyone made them stronger, and my parents were living proof of that, as were many other people in our neighbourhood. My mum always stressed to me how the war and severe rationing made people pull together, and how proud she was of her country's ironclad patriotism. To this day, this is a big part of who I am. I will always go around my house looking for lights and or water to turn off and such, due to the fact that both of my parents instilled in me this sense of never wasting anything. When you grow up taking one bath a week to conserve water and rationing your meals because you never knew when things could be taken away from you, it reminds you that it's always a good idea to conserve and not take anything for granted. One of my closest friends, Gary Saint, lived in the next street over. I'd known Gary since we were about 8 years old. He'd be at my house all the time. He'd even come on my parents' weekend trips to Jaywick and remained a loyal friend well into our adult lives together. There was a group of us that hung out together, like kids do. I remember it being a wonderful childhood, where members of our little gang were within shouting distance of each other's houses. To anyone passing by, Boundary Road and the surrounding area looked like the countless other grey and dreary English cityscapes. But it was a thriving, colourful place, inhabited and enhanced by people of many cultures. We all lived alongside many immigrants from the Indian subcontinent and the Caribbean, including a huge influx of Jamaicans, who brought with them the sound of reggae, which would influence many musicians in the 1960s. As I walked home from school each day, the air was thick with the aromas of many different and wild-smelling foods. All the various kinds of pungent curries and spices, fresh ginger, and those mouth-watering, aromatic smells gave our neighbourhood a rich ethnic flavour, both figuratively and literally. That is not to say we didn't have our fair share of racism on our streets. Many Brits harboured deep anger toward the influx of Indians and Pakistanis, who were encouraged to come to the country for work. They called it Paki bashing. I knew kids who were singled out and attacked simply because they were Indian or Pakistani. I never understood it. Being around people of different ethnic groups was nothing new to me. My mum's oldest sister, My Auntie Dorothy had three daughters, my first cousins. They were all married to black men, so a part of my family is multiracial. To me, it was strange to see the separatism of races pushed by propaganda. Nothing new there. It was no surprise that white-bred Britain, with its strong Anglo-Saxon foundation, would have a problem with the newly integrated brown population. By the early 1960s, when I was just 7 or 8 years old.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.